ready to bless. So sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride as we take you out of this crazy world and into a spirit-filled, life-changing gospel show service. Already in progress.
Welcome to Salvation Saloon, Water Gold Church. As you can see, I've been taking my weather advice from reruns of the weather back in August. That's a nice balmy day for me, but that's what happens when you come from Wyoming, I guess. Any rate, we're gonna start off with for a lot of you guys. I think almost everybody here probably knew Yusuf. If you didn't, you missed an opportunity. But Yusuf came to us several years ago. First met him about 10, 12 years ago. And he was in his 20s. And I thought, now this is an unusual guy. Okay, because I mean, he's exorbitantly talented. But more important, his level of commitment to the Lord was amazing for his age. Amen. What I didn't know, and I came to understand as I got closer to him, is how much he struggled through his teenage years with, understanding who he wanted to be, getting into drugs and all sorts of other nonsense, and came to the Lord, and man, he just became something special. I ended up writing a song, and as I wrote the song, I said, holy smokes, I'm writing a song about Yusuf's life. Now, so this became Yusuf's song, and we're going to dedicate this to him today, all right? And we're here to have fun, so you guys have fun, because we're going to have fun. We don't want to leave you behind, you know? Life is hard. It's give and take. The harder you try, the less that you make. And your spirit breaks. Well, it's a nice, warm day. We just all cuddle up together. What a lot of fun. I'm sorry, I just can't help but have fun when I get here. It's just my favorite place to be all week, you know?
Everybody's got a story to tell. Everybody's got a wound to be healed. I wanna believe there's beauty here. 'Cause oh, I get so tired of holding on. As you make a change in your life, I'm going to read the word that can change your life. And it comes from Psalm 143, verse 8. And it reads like this: Let the morning bring me word of your unfailing love, for I have put my trust in you. Show me the way I should go, for to you I entrust my life. Amen.
darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. Well, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. Well, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lies. Not afraid to leave my past behind. Well, I won't be shaken. Well, I won't be shaken. Well, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Well, there's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. Well, there's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. Well, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Well, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Your love. I'm standing in your love.
Standing in your love.
Standing in your
All right. Hey, good morning, everybody. What a beautiful Florida morning.
Wow. I woke up. It was 37 degrees in clear water, and I looked online back home in Maine. It's only 10 degrees colder up there. Oh, my gosh. John Olson was saying, we got to move south. All right. Well, hey, welcome. I'm so glad you guys are here. Welcome to our happy hour service at the world-famous Salvation Saloon. And for those of you who may be here for the very first time, as always, we like to start our services out by letting you guys know we are so glad you guys are here. And we truly believe God is going to bless you guys today. There is one thing we would ask of you, though. if you don't mind, and that is if you would just grab one of these little yellow cards that you see all over the place, and if you would, store your name in that, tell us where you're from, that'd be cool. But then if you don't mind, if you'd hold on to this card till the end of the service and write down the bottom in the comment section, tell us what you thought. We're always kind of curious. So if you do that, that would be great. And then on your way out, just hold this card till the end. On your way out, there'll be a bucket by the door, and you can drop this card in that bucket. But just tell us what you thought. We'd love to hear what you guys think. Anyways, again, welcome. We're glad you're here. You are our guest, so sit back, hang on, enjoy the ride. Now, we also have a few other purposes for these cards, though, and that is if there happens to be a birthday or an anniversary, it could be just about anything that you think we got to know about, well, you can put it on this card 1 week in advance. But the main reason we have these cards is for prayer. So if you're here and you have a need in your life, put that need down on this card and give God an opportunity to show himself strong, because prayer does work. Amen? You believe that? This is what the Bible tells us. Bible tells us that our God is a present help in times of trouble, but also tells us that sometimes we have not because we ask not. So again, put your needs down on this card. All right, well, here at the Salvation Saloon, we are a family. Like every family, we try to make sure that we recognize each other. And by God, I believe we got us a birthday, don't we, Rob? All right, happy birthday, Artie. And there is a game we play each and every week, and that game is called Name That Saloonatic. If you are here for the first time, just so you do know, we do call our congregation members Saloonatics. And every week, we try to get a picture, usually an old picture. We throw it up and try to guess who it is. So see what you can do with this. See if you can tell me who this Saloonatic is. Stud muffin that guy is, huh? Any guesses? John? John Olson? Really? Pastor Bill. Dave George. Well, let's find out. Well, the real Saloonatic, please stand up. And it is, where is he? Oh, come on, get up. It is, it's John Olson. We did not fool you guys. All right, well, that, I think, is all we've got. I got no other announcements, so on with the show. I'm going to bring Bill up here, and he is going to pray God's blessing on the remainder of our service, and then we'll get to God's Word.
Good morning, y'all. What a beautiful day. My dog's not liking it very much. It took forever for her to do her business. I was like, if you would just get it done, we could go inside. But craziness, right? So, you know, this week, so much going on. It's really such an exciting time. So much NFL going on. So many big games today. So get your stuff done this morning. You can watch all afternoon. That's the plan, right? I tried to do my grocery shopping and all that, and I'm standing there at Publix, and I'm waiting for my credit approval to get some eggs. I have to finance them now, but I'm looking at the people rushing around and just trying to get stuff done, and I'm thinking, man, what's going on in their world? You know, is today a good day for them, or is it a sad day? What are they looking forward to tonight, or regretting it, or what's going on? You know, you're just trying to figure out what's happening with all these people as they twirl around you, you know? And sometimes, you know, we forget to do that. And I always pray, God, just let me see somebody that needs a smile or help or something. Just let me see what you see. Let me see with your eyes. And, you know, I was thinking of that scripture that in Habakkuk, I think it says, I've heard of your fame. And I've heard of your great deeds. And repeat them in me in our lifetime, you know. And that's, you know, I was thinking about that. Well, where would you hear of those deeds if you were just that person at Publix running around? You know, unless you had a Christian in your life somewhere, where are you going to hear about that? Well, it used to be you would hear about that stuff at church, back when we were a country that went to church. But we're not anymore, you know. So that's the reason why we're always trying to encourage everybody to invite people to events and invite people to church so that they can hear of God's fame and his great deeds, and that he stands ready, willing, and able to do them for all of us over and over and over again. And I just, at that moment, felt so blessed to know Jesus. And I felt so sad for them that they may not, you know. But I didn't think it would be good to start preaching there in the checkout counter, so get locked up for that these days. But anyway, that's where my heart's at today, so you just be praying for folks that God would just begin to draw them here. Just draw them, right? I don't care. Let them come one time and hear the message that changes their life and we never see them again. That's fine. You know, we're not looking to get rich. We don't have a helicopter. There's no private jet. You know, we just want people to know Jesus. So be praying for that God will just start drawing them here, even if it's just to hear one message and then go. Amen? So I noticed somebody brought a heater in. I mean, this is, who did that? Oh my, okay. It's, you know, it's a little nippy, but come on. We used to, in the 20s, I mean, used to ride motorcycles and, you know, way worse than this. And your beard would be all frozen and you had snot sickles. And, you know, and now we got portable heaters. Yeah, come to the saloon. They're tough. All those bikers. Lord help us. So listen, we got a great day, and we're so glad you're here, and we just love to share and have fun with you, but it is serious business, too, and the church has bills and expenses that have to get taken care of, and that's why God said, you put your money there. What you owe me, what I've blessed you with, my percentage goes here. Put it in my house, my church, right? And then you can continue that mission that God's given us, because we're uniquely qualified to reach a specific segment of society that might not be comfortable maybe at North Dunedin Baptist or at Calvary Chapel or any of the other great churches we know. But they'd fit in here. And for that to happen, we have to be here. And to be here, in America, we have to pay bills. Right? And I'm one of those bills. So, but y'all don't pay me. Anyway, let me pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that we could be in the house this morning, God. We thank you that we can just rest and relax in your presence, God, that we can laugh, that we can celebrate each other, and we can celebrate you most of all. So, Father, we ask that you be glorified in everything that happens here today, and that if nothing else is accomplished, that the name of Jesus Christ be lifted up, that you be glorified in all that you are because of who you are, not because of what you've done, just simply because of who you are. Father, we love you, and we ask that you would bless the gift and the giver this morning. Lord, multiply it and expand it and allow us to use it for your mission that you've appointed us with. We love you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, I have to say that I'm so thankful for Anne and John Alton. They were the one who brought this. And it was an answer for my prayer. So.
Speaks a person from Puerto Rico. Okay, well, you figure that out.
Praise God. And it's always well.
Amen.
All right?
Amen.
Peace like a
back for us, to take us to the mansion he's prepared.
And the Lord hates the day when my faith shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the drum shall resound, and the
That was beautiful. Amen. Good job, Nitty Gritty Church Band. All right. So today we're in chapter 6 of 2 Corinthians. And to set things up by way of review, it was in chapter 5 that Paul spoke a lot on the importance of serving our God faithfully. And that's important. Because for one, well, we're going to be rewarded for our faithful service. But also, because man, it's just the reasonable thing to do. Amen? It's just the reasonable thing to do. And it is so because as Paul urged all believers in Romans 12:1, he said, in view of God's mercy to us, then we're to offer our bodies to him as a living sacrifice. A sacrifice that is holy and pleasing to God, for this is our reasonable service, and it is the our proper way of worship. And it's reasonable because if Jesus died for us, then, yeah, it's just proper for us to now live our lives for him. Amen? But here's the thing with that, right? It's not as if, you know, we live for him like we're, you know, like some menial servant. But, right, as God's adoptive sons and daughters, Paul said that we are actually his ambassadors and his representatives, right? So basically, our labors for our God on this earth, well, it is just our duty within the family business, right? The business of persuading others to also accept the great love and grace of God. And so that was what we learned in chapter 5. And so that now brings us to chapter 6, where Paul now elaborates on that in verse 1 by saying this. He says, as God's co-workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. as God's co-workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. Now, to be a mortal man, right, who has been assigned as a co-worker and a representative of Almighty God himself, well, that is an honor that can only be attributed to God's grace, right? Because that grace, right, is his unmerited and undeserved favor. And man, that is something that should never be taken lightly or taken in vain, right? So we should not accept that grace and then make a mockery of it by not living and representing our God the way we should. Amen? And so in verse 2, Paul says this. He says, for he, our God, says this. And this is actually from Isaiah chapter 49, where God said, in the time of my favor, right, or my grace, I heard you. And in the day of salvation, I helped you. So I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the time of God's grace. Now is the day of salvation. All right, great news. Amen? It's great news because it tells us that salvation, right, salvation from Almighty God himself, that is available to us right now. Right now. It's available to any of us right now. But I also think Paul kind of says this here also for the benefit of those Judaizers, right? Those Jewish believers who were still depending on all the rituals and the laws of the old covenant to help them earn their salvation. But Paul is letting them know that this new and better covenant, right, this new and better covenant of grace, well, it is not about what they can do for Christ, but it's about what Christ has done for them, right? And that means that they do not have to be bound to all the requirements of the law so that they can be worthy of their salvation. Because as it states in Ephesians chapter 2, right? Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. It is by grace, right? Through faith alone that we are saved. And not by our own efforts, because our salvation is a gift from God. It's a gift from God, not by our works, so that no man can boast. And that's why Paul said earlier in his letters to the Corinthians, he said that the one who boasts, well, he can only boast in the Lord. The one who boasts, he can only boast in the Lord, right? The Lord whose salvation is freely given and freely received. And what that means is that we do not have to first clean up our acts, right? Or we don't have to jump through all these hoops for God to accept us, but we just need to accept him. Amen? We just need to accept him, and that is what makes today, right now, the day of salvation. All right. Now, what's sad about that, though, is that there are some people who do acknowledge that, and yet they still put it off. They put it off, and they procrastinate. But you know what? There's no guarantees of a tomorrow. Am I right? No guarantees of a tomorrow. So we need to act. We need to act because, again, as Paul just said, now is the accepted time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. That is not something that we should put off. And then in verse 3, Paul says this. He says, we put no stumbling block in anyone's path so that our ministry will not be discredited. Now, in verse 1, Paul said this. Paul said that as co-workers, as God's co-workers, we are not to receive God's grace in vain, right? And so it's here that Paul is saying basically that, hey, listen, I have practiced what I preached, right? I have practiced what I preached, so the reputation of my ministry, it cannot be discredited. And that was so true of the Apostle Paul, because he not only talked the talk, but the man walked the walk, right? And so again, as ambassadors and representatives and co-workers of God, of Almighty God, again, our witness, pretty important thing to maintain. It's a pretty important thing to maintain. So in verse 4, Paul says this. He says, as servants of God, we commend ourselves, right? Or we commend our faithfulness, right? Our faithful service to God, and we do it in every way. And now, He's going to kind of lay out his resume to describe what every way means, and it means in great endurance. It means I was talking about a faithfulness that lasts, right? Lasts in troubles, in hardships, and distresses. Verse 5, in beatings, imprisonments, and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger, as well as in verse 6, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit, and in sincere love. In verse 7, in truthful speech, and in the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left. And then in verse 8, through glory and dishonor, bad report and good report, genuine yet regarded or slandered as impostors. In verse 9, known yet regarded as unknown, right, ignored, dying and yet we live on, beaten and yet not killed. And then in conclusion, in verse 10, Paul says, sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. Poor, yet making many rich, right? Spiritually rich. Having nothing, yet possessing everything. Having nothing, yet possessing everything. All right. Personally, I cannot relate to a whole lot of this, right? Because thank God my calling and ministry hasn't required me to endure all the things that the Apostle Paul had to endure. But to a lesser degree, I think we all can relate, right? And I think we can relate just as Paul stated earlier when he said this, and that was, he said that although outwardly or physically we are wasting away, life's a struggle, yet inwardly, spiritually, we are being renewed day by day, right? Because our light and momentary troubles in this fallen world, well, they are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So, we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. So, yeah, you know what? We may have nothing here in this temporary world, but because we walk by faith and not by sight, you know what? We do possess it all. Right? We possess everything, right? Because just as it says in Romans 8:17, it says that if we are God's children, then we are his heirs, right? Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. All right. What does that glory consist of? Well, the Bible says this. Bible says that no eye has seen and no ear has heard, nor has any mind even conceived of the things that our God has prepared for those who love him. And what that says is our inheritance, right, as heirs of God, right, as co-heirs with Christ, well, it is going to be better than anything that we have ever seen or heard or could ever imagine. Amen? And Paul's faith in that is what caused him to endure all those things that he went through, right? And all that he went through, that served as the proof of his faith. Amen? That validated his faith. Because as James said in his apostle, I'm going to kind of paraphrase this just a little, but James said that, you know, hey, you guys, you can brag all day about all the faith that you have, but as for me, well, he said, I'll show you my faith by my actions, right? By my works, by the things that I do. And after seeing Paul's resume here, that's exactly what he did as well. Amen? That resume proves him to be genuine, proves him to be the real deal. And then in verse 11, he said this. He says, we have spoken freely or plainly to you, Corinthians, and we have opened wide our hearts to you, right? We have expressed and demonstrated our love. So in verse 12, we are not withholding our affection from you, but you are withholding yours from us. So in verse 13, Paul says, as a fair exchange, I speak as to my children. Open wide your hearts also. Open wide your hearts also. Now, Paul really did feel like he was a father to this church, to these Corinthians, right? Because, again, he was the one who had established their church, right? And he was the one who had established their faith in Christ. And if you think about it, that was really a pretty big deal, right? Because these Corinthians, right, they were a bunch of pagans, right? These guys were idol worshipers, right, before Paul came and presented them with the gospel. And, you know, when he was there with them, they did love him. They did love Paul. But then we know that Paul left, right? He was there for about 18 months, and then God had called him to go elsewhere. He went to Ephesus, and he established a church there. But after he left, what happened is that is when those Judaizers showed up, and they attempted to infiltrate the church, and their contrary beliefs, it created a lot of confusion and division, and that caused kind of a wedge between this church, many in this church, and Paul. And in the two letters that he wrote to them, what he has been trying to reestablish that relationship that they once had, and throughout those two letters, he's been conveying over and over again, he's been conveying his love and his sincerity. And here he's just asking them to, you know, just recognize that, recognize my efforts, and respond in kind. Respond in kind. Now again, as Paul began this chapter, okay, he stated that we are not to receive God's grace in vain, right? By making a mockery of it, by the things we do, and by the choices we make as ambassadors and representatives of God. And so by way of some wise advice, well, it's Paul who says this in verse 14. He says, do not be yoked together with unbelievers. Do not be unequally yoked. Don't be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? Well, I'll tell you what fellowship. Bad fellowship, right? Because as Paul stated earlier, right, in 1 Corinthians 15:33, he said this. He said, be not deceived, because bad company corrupts good character. Right? Or how about this from the wisdom of Solomon, who in Proverbs 13:20, he said that whoever walks with the wise becomes wise, but a companion of fools will suffer harm. Will suffer harm. Anyways, this is really some great advice here, and it's great advice for our spiritual preservation. Amen? And that would certainly be important when it comes to choosing a husband or a wife. Right? Because obviously for a believer to marry an unbeliever, well, that would create a serious ongoing conflict, right? A conflict that would no doubt hinder a believer's ability to live their lives fully for God. Because in that relationship, there's always going to be that spiritual tug of war taking place. And I'll just tell you, I have personally seen the results of that, where it has turned the believer's life into a literal nightmare. A literal nightmare. Bill knows what I'm talking about. So, again, great advice, do not go there. Do not go there, right? To elaborate, now Paul continues to elaborate on the subject, and in verse 15 he says this. He says, what harmony is there between Christ and Belial, or Christ and the devil? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? In verse 16, what agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God, right? We are the temple of the living God. As God has said this, I will live with them. I will live in them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. And man, what a beautiful promise from God. Amen? Right? A promise that declares just how intimate our relationship truly is with God. Now, so, I mean, we have this special relationship with God, and it's a relationship that is that's not a legal relationship, right?
It's not like we have a relationship with God that's based on our ability to keep all the laws and the rituals of the old covenant. But our relationship is based on that new and better covenant, again, of grace, right? The new and better covenant of grace that the God who so loved the world established when he sent his son Jesus, right? He sent Jesus to pay a debt that he didn't know because we had a debt we couldn't pay. And so since we have such an intimate and personal relationship with our God, then therefore, because all those relationships that Paul had just mentioned are totally contrary to each other, right? They're at odds with each other, then in verse 17, then therefore, as the Lord says, come out from them and be separate. Come out from them and be separate. Touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you. And what that means for us in verse 18 is I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Amen. Again, what a beautiful promise. What a beautiful promise. Now, earlier, I think I kind of messed up here, because earlier as Paul began his examples here of those unequally yoked relationships, well, I did say that, hey, here's some good advice for you guys. But actually, this is more than just some good advice. Because as he closes, we actually see that this is from God himself, right? This is from the lips of Almighty God himself. So beyond advice, this is a command, right? Come out from among them and be separate. Touch no unclean thing and I will receive you. So, so this is beyond good advice. It's a command, right? It is a command, actually, that will keep our relationship with God strong and secure. Strong and secure. Because here's the thing. If we have one foot in the world and one foot in heaven, then we're either going to have too much of the world to be happy in Christ or too much of Christ to be happy in the world. Amen? That's just how it works. And so it is never a good idea to compromise our faith. Because again, all it does is it's just going to create that spiritual tug of war. And we don't need that in our lives. Amen? That's never been beneficial. And so in closing, as Joshua said, we need to choose this day who we will serve. But as for me and my house, well, Joshua said this. He says, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. And I certainly hope that is where we all stand as well. And that concludes chapter 6. It's kind of a short chapter. But some really good stuff. Amen? All right. Billy, come on up and give us your closing thoughts.
All right, great stuff, huh? You know, I'm always reminded of where Paul says that, listen, if you're having trouble understanding all of this stuff or you just can't figure it out, just imitate me. Just do what I do and don't do what I don't do. And you'll be good. You can be 100% assured that you will be in the presence of God someday because you got it right. Because you followed my example. Wow. How many of us could say that? Just do what I do and you'll be good. You'll be golden. Right? Missing nothing. You'll be perfect. Well, I couldn't say that. You know, I tell people all the time, don't follow me, follow Jesus. Right? Because, you know, I'm just a guy. So, you know, with a great calling and a great privilege, but I don't have any, like, you know, secret deal with the Lord. I struggle with stuff, too. I live in this crazy world. So, you know, we all have things, and there's always going to be issues. But we work on them, right? We keep trying. We dust ourselves off, and we keep moving forward, and we press on. so that at the end God could say, you know what, you did fight the good fight. You fought till the end, you know. So let's go down swinging, but let's be mindful of the fact that, you know, God will meet us where we're at, but he doesn't want to keep us where we're at. We're supposed to get different, get better, and behave more Christ-like. Because sometimes the only gospel people will read is you. So, you know, we got to walk the walks. A lot of people are good at talking the talk, but it's the walking part that's difficult. You know, like I always said, if anybody ever accused you of being a Christian, could they prove it? You know, or are you going to somebody that, oh, what? No way. That one's a Christian? Oh, curses like the rest of us all day long. Sounds just like everybody else. So I didn't notice any difference. That'd be a horrible thing to hear, right? So anyway, something to think about. Something to think about. So we got a great day. Lots of football today. Big games. The Giants, my team, right? We have been through the mill. It's just been really difficult, right? Bad couple of years, bunch of years. And then they're going up against the Minnesota Vikings, whose quarterback is the son of my friend Pastor Don. So I always kind of root for him, but just blame the Giants. But the Giants got a snowball's chance even if they win today. So I don't know. I'm conflicted on the whole thing. So. And then tomorrow the Bucks play. And we all know God loves the Bucks. So lots going on. So anyway, enjoy yourself. Have fun this weekend. Start thinking about folks that you know that need to hear the message that we all enjoy, we all share, that we know that we are, like Paul said, the co-heirs to that kingdom, because Jesus is our Lord and Savior, and he may not be theirs because they haven't heard it, right? And where are they going to hear it? You know, bring them here. They'll hear it here. You know, they'll definitely hear it here because that's what we do. Line by line, verse by verse, week in and week out, we preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and the good news. Because that's the only thing that will ever change anybody's existence. You know, as you look at the folks in your life and the different situations that they're in, they all may be different, but the answer is the same. The answer is Jesus. And the answer is never less Jesus. It's always more. And it's never less church. It's more church, because where else are you going to hear about those great deeds and God's great fame? At church, and be reminded. You know, and so many times folks say, oh, well, I'm going through a lot right now, so I haven't been to church. That is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. I'm going through a lot, so I need to be at church. I need to be with my fellow brothers and sisters, some of whom who have been through this very thing and can tell me what God did for them to keep my faith strong until I get to the other side of this thing. Amen. That's what church is for. That's why it says, forsake not the coming together of the body, so that we can encourage each other and lift each other up. Because I don't know who you live with, but my dog can't preach that to me. My roommate can't preach that to me. My neighbors are nuts. They can't preach that to me. The only people that can remind me of that is you. You. And you won't all fit in my house. So I have to come here. And that's why we come together, to remind each other of who Jesus is and what he has done and that he hasn't changed. The mission is the same. And if he's led us through this, and this, like Paul was saying this morning before we started, he's had a lot of stuff going on, but every time he looks back in his life when he's had a lot of stuff going on, he can see that God always showed up and always did what needed to be done and always moved, and it's always worked for their benefit, always. Always. God is faithful and he keeps his promises. So we have to just do our little part and share that with folks out there because they need it. They need it. I don't care if they're rich or poor, black or white. Who cares? I don't care who they voted for, where they went to school. I don't care who their mama is. They need Jesus. So we all need a Savior. And if you don't have Jesus Christ as your Savior, what in the world are you doing? Why would you want to face a single day in this hard life without having a relationship with the guy who created all of it, including you? See, I tried all the other stuff. Many of us here have. We've tried it all. It doesn't work. We were created to have a relationship with the Creator, and nothing else can ever fill that spot. Nothing else can ever fit where only God can fit. He designed it that way. And try as you might and as you will, you can waste your whole life and your whole, every dime you've ever made, and you will never be satisfied. You will never find the peace and comfort that God has for you unless you know Him as your Savior. So say this prayer with me. Say, "Dear God, I don't have all the answers, but I know you do. So from this point on, I want to rely on you by accepting Jesus as my Lord and Savior. So please forgive me, make all things new, and by the power of your grace, I will now seek to follow you and serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name." Amen. Hey, God bless you. If you said that prayer today, we're so excited. There's a party going on in heaven right now. And welcome to the family. You know, let somebody know. Let us know. We want to encourage you. Let you know what next steps are so that you can move from where you're at. Because God met you where you are, but you don't have to stay where you are. There's a whole bunch that God has for you. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to be in your house and in your presence. Lord, we just thank you for this family that you've created here, and we're mindful of all those that are not with us. Lord, if they're feeling unwell, or if they have a sickness or disease in their body, we ask, Lord, that you would intervene, touch them, Lord, and bring them whatever it is that they need according to your will. Father, we love you, and we know that every good thing comes from your throne. All the provision and benefit and every promise, we accept them and we love you for them, God. We thank you for them. Ask always that you protect our political leaders. Lord, give them wisdom to make decisions that are beneficial to the people. Always, Lord, please protect our troops and our first responders. And bless all the families represented here until we can gather again in your name next week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Love y'all. See you next week. Please help and stay breakdown. Breakdown. Especially the young guys. Young guys carry heavy stuff. Young guy, heavy stuff.